Sleep is crucially important, and I think we've moved from this attitude from it's an indulgence, a waste of time, almost an illness that needs a cure, to a realization that if you want to come up with innovative solutions to complex problems, then a night of sleep has been clearly demonstrated to do that for you.
For something as universally important to human life as sleep, mysteries surrounding its necessity and utility have only just been recently uncovered.
Some of our biggest discoveries were in the 1970s or 1980s, and so it makes it a really exciting field because it seems as though we're uncovering new insights each and every day on the link between our sleep and our waking success.
Where in the past, a lot of people thought that it's great to work long hours and get little sleep, with a lack of sleep sometimes leading to 20-30% reduced productivity on the next day, it becomes pretty clear that the smarter choice often is to sleep an hour longer than an hour less.
And though we now understand some of how sleep benefits our life and health spans, some scientists are going further to find out how sleep and what happens there can be harnessed to further expand our understanding.
It's easy to memorize things. That makes you smart if you can spit back a lot of facts. But if you want to be wise, if you really want wisdom, you got to know when and how and why to use that information. And that's what your brain figures out while you're sleeping.
There's all kinds of things we know dreams are related to, the memory consolidation, emotion the next day. But there are no studies, and I mean literally no studies, which try to manipulate those on purpose.
There's no just one reason for sleep. I published a paper a couple of years ago about this, generated quite a bit of irritation from my sleep colleagues, because the title of the paper is "There is no mystery to sleep." It's a period of physical inactivity where we have to do a whole bunch of biology. We basically slotted that important biology to the time when it is best suited, when we're not moving around, interacting with our world, getting more sensory information in. In the same way, people have asked, why do we sleep? You could equally ask, I think, why are we awake? It's to do a whole bunch of critical stuff.
All of the research shows that the greatest benefit to our health and our well-being is when you can consistently make between 7 and 9 hours of sleep part of your regular routine. Sleep really matters for our cardiovascular health. Over the course of our sleep, our blood pressure actually drops to its lowest point in the typical 24-hour day. Individuals who aren't sleeping enough consistently are at much greater risk for high blood pressure and then subsequent cardiovascular disease. During sleep, there's an accelerated clearance of toxins in the brain. And that happens at a 60% increased rate, that removal of toxins, during sleep than during wakefulness.
We've understood the importance of sleep, because we appreciate now what you become if you haven't got it. If you think about our biology of any organism, what it needs to do is deliver the right materials in the right concentration to the right tissues at the right time of day to succeed. What our circadian systems do is give that temporal, that timing structure. The analogy I've made, it's a bit like an orchestra. You've got lots and lots of rhythms going on, and they all need to be coordinated to generate a symphony. And of course, if you don't have that coordination, if you shoot the conductor, then instead of a symphony, you have a cacophony. And that's what lack of a circadian control would be. You'd have biological cacophony.
As human beings, we're really not built to make sweeping changes in our sleep routine. We're really truly creatures of habit.
There's also now a preponderance of evidence that burning the candle at both ends doesn't lead to increased productivity.
The societal loss that comes with sleep deprivation or too little sleep is about $400 billion in the United States alone. It's pretty much due to three causes. On the one hand, people with too little sleep have a higher mortality risk. Secondly, there is a workplace productivity factors such as increased absenteeism from work or lower productivity at work. And finally, there is also factors around skill development that people who don't get enough sleep suffer in their skill development.
Going beyond why and how we sleep, some scientists are pushing the envelope in terms of how we can use sleep and the dreams that come with it to better understand ourselves.
Dreams in particular serve to let us explore possible connections between the events of our day and other older memories that we might never think of connecting them to. So when we dream, our brains go looking for weakly associated memories that might be of potential use in solving problems of our day, and tries to construct a narrative story of what that might look like. We might be dealing with a coworker or a boss at work. And in a dream at night, that topic might be activated. It might connect to early fights I had with my father, and some in particular that are remarkably close to the fight I'm having with my boss now. And in playing out that dream, the brain calculates that this is actually a useful association. So the next day I'm in the office with my boss again, I'm about to say something, and all of a sudden, for reasons unknown to my conscious mind, up comes this image of me and my father having this fight. And I literally pause and I laugh. And I say to my boss, I don't think this fight really has anything to do with you. The concept is, from an evolutionary point of view, the functions of dreaming occur while we dream. We never need to remember them.
It's hard to overstate the kind of different brain you get in sleep. It's totally weird. You're amnesic and you're hallucinatory, you're delusional. I think got to sleep in dreams by being interested in how it was possible that someone could get out of their own way, or how it was possible that I could be in my own way. In general, how I could be multiple people at once, and how sleep was an access point to seeing those other people.
In order to make those connections more controllable, Robert Stickold, Adam Haar, and others at MIT Fluid Interfaces have created a process and device to implant dreams into people as they fall asleep. Your first reaction might be, hey, they made Inception in real life. But far from pulling off a high-stakes dream heist, the creators of Dormio, the device the team uses to achieve targeted dream incubation, have higher-minded, if less lucrative, aims.
Targeted dream incubation, if you take away the targeted, dream incubation is a practice that's been going on for millennia, and it's basically a kind of supplication or prayer. It's an ask. Typically, in spiritual context, people before sleep would perform a kind of ritual. They would fast for a few days, or they would sleep in a holy place. And that would be a way of asking for a big dream. That could be a healing dream, a dream which prescribed a remedy. It could be an introspective dream, often a prophetic dream. What we were interested in is taking some of those ideas from dream incubation and about the kind of moment of sleep onset as a really fertile moment to change dream content, and to add in a bit of specificity. I think there's a kind of creepiness that some people find to the phrase dream control. And so I try to be clear that there's no chance that I can say you're gonna have a dream where you're Tiger Woods and then you turn into a tree and then you feel bad about it and then everything turns red. And like, no, that's not it. What we can do is we can plant a seed. Basically, it's a sensor which sits on the hand and has some information about your heart and some information about your muscles and some information about your skin and the sweat on it. And it tells you a little bit about where you are in between wake and sleep, because you don't fall asleep all at once. You fall asleep in stages, in about 9 stages. And so right about when you're halfway in between those stages, it'll say, hey, why don't you think about a tree? Literally with audio. And then it'll let you go down right about to that 9th stage. And then it'll say, hey, what are you thinking about? And you'll wake up a little bit and say, oh, I don't know, my toes became leaves. And then you say, okay, you can go back to sleep now. And then it'll go right back down about halfway. Do it again, do it again. That's it. Rinse and repeat. Bunch of times. So like in a 45 minute nap, you get like 5 or 6 dreams usually. In terms of possible benefits for dream incubation, I think the smaller answer is we can look at any study which has shown us a correlation between dream content and some kind of cognitive change. And we can say, I'm gonna make that correlation a cause. So to give you an example, hey, it seems like people who start dreaming in a foreign language do better in a foreign language course than those that don't. And then we would ask a question, oh, can we help people along to start dreaming in French in their French language course and see then a causal improvement in their performance in that course? That's interesting. We also have some understanding of dreams and their relationship to the progression of depressive disorders or of post-traumatic stress or of anxiety disorders. We have a sense of their importance for pre-surgery anxiety. I think the thing that's more interesting and perhaps more important is what happens when you leave people with a tool that, even in a very small way, can show them a part of themselves they haven't seen before.
Though Haar and Stigold are optimistic about TDI, they were part of the first group to warn against its potential for misuse. In a letter posted in November 2021, they warned against advertisers invading your dream space, something that was, in fact, already happening. As a 2021 Super Bowl advertising tie-in, Molson Coors encouraged people to watch a short video before bed featuring beer cans and flowing mountain streams, then listen to an 8-hour soundscape, all incentivized with free drinks from the company.
Am I what you imagined?
Can you tell me what you were dreaming?
I was dreaming about waterfalls.
I think it was something to do with pores.
The alarming implications of it were troubling to the team behind Dormio.
So there was a study a few years ago that showed if you take people who wanted to quit smoking and while they were asleep, exposed them to the mixed smells of cigarettes and rotting fish, they would, over the next couple of weeks, end up smoking only half as much cigarettes as the control group who got no smells at all. But there's two important things to know about that study. First of all, nobody, when they woke up, reported remembering having been exposed to the smells. So it was done completely out of their waking awareness. And when the same combined smells were played to subjects while they were awake, it had no effect at all. So what if instead of pairing it with rotten fish, they had paired it with roses or with chocolate? You should be able to push people towards buying more alcoholic drinks, buying more cigarettes.
It's the last bastion of completely private, independent world building that we have. And let's just not give it away. Simple.